Good morning and welcome to another edition of our online worship service. We're so glad that you tuned in with us. We ask that you would like this, that you would share this. We've been in here in the sanctuary worshiping. Our musicians have been playing that old hymn of the church. And certainly on a first Sunday, you made it to the first Sunday in December. The many dangers, toils, and snares, you are still here. Father, we thank you. We love you. We give your name praise, honor, and glory. You are a righteous king. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for bringing us to this 12th month and a year that has been completely unpredictable, full of tragedy and full of turmoil and trials and tribulations. But yet we are still here because you said so. So God, we thank you for giving us another Sunday morning to praise your name, to hear a word from you, to lift you up, to be equipped and refreshed for the week ahead. And we pray now, God, that you would do something extraordinary in our mind, in our soul, in our being, in our body. We love you because you loved us first. In Jesus' name we do pray. Come on, if you love God, why don't you put your hands together? I'm telling you, we love the Lord. Our announcements shall come after our song selection. Our song selection, actually, this is first Sunday. And after our song selection, we will participate in our communion. And then following our communion, whatever announcements we have for the day. If you're at home with us, we want you to prepare to take a meal with us. We have our traditional wafer and juice today in our sanctuary. But if you've been rolling with us since the month of April, as we've gone online, then you understand that every first Sunday, we've encouraged you to take a meal that will boost your immune system. And so if you're at home watching us online, why don't you go ahead and put in that comment section what you are using for your communion today. We're going to share a meal after our choir gives us our morning selection. Let's give them a hand praise as they come now.
Sent down from glory, many things,
you are on earth, oh, holy King of
life. Oh, yeah. Singing bread of heaven, sent down from glory. Your name, Jesus.
Oh,
awesome ruler, Gentile redeemer, God with us,
God with us, the living true, and what a friend we have.
Oh, yeah.
You are
God with us,
God with us, the living true, and what a friend we have.
Oh, yeah.
You are
Jesus, Jesus,
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
That's what we call
that's
you.
That's what we call you.
You were born in a manger. What we call
That's
you,
we call you.
Man born saved,
put on the tree. You died to save man, Jesus.
Come on and hear me say,
Jesus.
That's what we call you.
If you believe that, come on, put your hands together. If you call him Jesus, count him as the living word. On that night when Jesus was betrayed, he gathered his disciples in an upper room there with him, shared with them a final meal before that awful surgery we call the crucifixion. He raised a loaf of bread toward heaven, and he broke it. And this is what he said: "This is my body, which is broken for you. As often as ye eat of this bread, do it in remembrance of me." And they ate together. In that same place, he poured wine into a cup, raised it, and said, "This is my body that is broken for you. As often as ye drink of this cup, do it in remembrance of me." And they drank together. It is a reminder to you of the value that God has placed on your life. You are and have always been a child of the King. Our morning announcement shall follow at this time.
December 6th through the 12th is National Handwashing Awareness Week. 80% of communicable diseases can be transferred by touch or person-to-person contact. One of the best ways to reduce the spread of coronavirus and other diseases is to wash your hands often. Touching your face with dirty hands can spread sicknesses such as the common cold, pneumonia, and the flu. The two most important times to wash your hands are before and after preparing food and after going to the restroom. To keep everyone safe, follow these tips for healthy hand washing. It's recommended that you wash your hands for 30 seconds, or 15 seconds is recommended at the very least. Most bacteria on our hands live under your fingernails, so when you're washing, be sure to scrub underneath them. Damp hands are 1,000 times more likely to spread bacteria than dry hands. However, only 20% of people dry their hands after washing them. Reusable cloth towels can carry millions of bacteria. Using disposable paper towels is the cleanest way to dry your hands. Studies show people who wash their hands have 24% less sick days because of respiratory illnesses and 51% fewer sick days due to a sick stomach. For more information, visit cdc.gov. Thanks for listening and stay healthy.
I do hope that each of you will pay attention to that information as we keep ourselves healthy and those that are around us. For the purpose of preaching and teaching, I call your attention to Matthew's Gospel today, chapter 9. So grateful to have our leaders in worship today. And for preaching and teaching, verse 10 and verse 11, this is how it reads. "And it came to pass, as Jesus sat at meat in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, Why eateth your master with publicans and sinners? And it came to pass, as Jesus sat at meat in the house, behold, many publicans and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples." I want to lift up from a thought today, using as a subject, "He ate with sinners." He ate with sinners. It has been stated, ladies and gentlemen, that you should never waste your time trying to explain who you are to people who have already committed themselves to misunderstanding you. That the battle line of your peace is often found between your decision to choose your own happiness or someone else's judgment. Now, the truth is, we could learn a lot from each other if we really wanted to. And if we took the time to understand people before we judged people, we really might be surprised at what we would learn. Now, for one, I am amazed how many ways church folk make being a Christian a hard task. How we develop these narratives on things that we didn't create, and yet we seem to always have the angle or the perspective, and usually, if not almost always, we're wrong. And as a part of the body of Christ, we should seek to find people and search people out the same way Jesus did. Almost every child of God knows by heart John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Whosoever believes in him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. And that text is critical because John 3:16 does not say, for God so loved the church. It does not say, for God so loved the Christian. It says, for God so loved the world. The world includes both sinner and saint. It includes saved and unsaved. And that's why a text like this today is important. Jesus is having a meal with friends, and he could have, if he wanted to, only eaten with those who were saved. He could have, if he wanted to, only shared a meal with those who followed him. But the text says he ate with sinners. The chief complaint of the Pharisees is, why does your master eat with publicans? Why does Jesus have friends who are not saved? Why is Jesus eating with disciples and sinners? Sinners would include adulterers and thieves and murderers, Jews who did not keep the covenants of God, outcasts, prostitutes, the disdained of the community. And per the text, Jesus is very comfortable, to our surprise, being associated with that group. Jesus, as a matter of fact, the text says, is in the house of Matthew, a known publican who invites the rest of his unsaved friends. And maybe the reason why Jesus eats with tax collectors and sinners and publicans is because he knows that sinners have friends too. That just because that they are unsaved doesn't mean that they can't spend time with God. Some people, please hear me, some people don't know how to have but one friend at a time. Isn't it something how we pick and choose who we want to deal with when we want to deal with them? Isn't it something how people, grown folk, only know how to have one friend at a time? And I like the text, Jesus in Matthew's house, and not only does Matthew invite Jesus, but Matthew invites some of his unsaved friends. And Jesus, who knows all things, doesn't get up and leave, but he chooses to stay and eat with them. As a matter of fact, one text says that Jesus reclined with them. And I am surprised over the number of grown folk who get jealous over the fact that you meet and befriend new people, almost like how we used to do in elementary school. I don't know how it works for you, but I never held an audition for my best friend. Sometimes good friends just happen out of a combination of experiences. And maybe the reason why Jesus ate with sinners and disciples is to set the example for us that it is possible to have different kinds of friends. Maybe he did it because he understood that even sinners have needs. He ate with them. Everybody alive needs to eat. Eating is an act of survival. If you don't eat, you die. Eating is an exercise in keeping you alive. It's a sound of life. So Jesus was eating with sinners. Why? Because sinners need to eat. He was helping them survive. Note, he was not helping them sin, But he was helping them survive. Can I tell you why 10 of y'all in the room should have clapped right there? You should have shouted right there, because God never helped you sin, but he always helped you survive. You were doped out of your head and God helped you survive. You drunk more liquor than the law allowed, but God helped you survive. You slept with more people than Baskin Robbins got flavor, but God helped you survive. You lied and cheated and misused and abused. You cussed and you fought. God didn't help you sin, but he helped you survive. And I wish I had 10 people who would be honest and clap your hands if I'm preaching already. Follow the text. No sinner in the room asked the question, why is Jesus here? That question didn't come from the sinners. No, that question came from the church folk in the room. Why is Jesus eating with sinners? Here's my question. If you got such of a problem with him eating with them, why are you there too? Isn't this something, ladies and gentlemen, how Jesus chose to hang out with sinners, and sinners didn't mind hanging out with the master? And could it be the reason why people have stopped coming to church is not because they have an issue with God, but the hypocrisy of the people of God? He ate with them, and Pharisees are the ones who had the problem. They say to his disciples, not even to him. Why does your master eat with those kind of people? Look at what Jesus says. Look at his response. He overheard what they said to his disciples. And Jesus said, they that are whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. And then he says, go and learn what that means. I want to park my car, hang out, camp out right there for a minute. Jesus is eating with sinners, and Pharisees, church folk, religious folk, have an issue with Jesus. And Jesus says to them, the whole do not need a physician, but the sick. And then he says, go learn what that means. In other words, Jesus just dropped the bomb on them and didn't waste the time to teach them what it meant. He said, go figure it out. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, what it means is that we must get out of our minds that God will always make sense. Sometimes we missed God because God didn't make sense. We went to Sunday school, but God still didn't make sense. We've been in church all our lives and still miss God. We were religious and we miss God, because there are times when God will drop a word without an explanation. And so you have a revelation, but no education. I feel like I'm going to go somewhere today. Sometime God will give you the answer, but no equation. He will show you the destiny, but not tell you how to get there. He'll give you the proverb, but not the meaning. He said, the whole need a physician, but they that are sick. And then he said, now you go and figure it out. I ain't going to teach it. I'm not going to explain it to you, because I already know you don't even care. But I'm still going to tell you. Now you've got to figure it out yourself. Here is Jesus. Look at him. He's trying to show forgiveness to people who don't understand forgiveness. He's trying to show people how to love people who don't understand how to love people. He says in the text, he's trying to get people to change who don't want to change. The Pharisees insisted that sinners become righteous in order to gain acceptance before God. But Jesus flips it on their head and demands that religious folk accept sinners just the way they are. And isn't it amazing, ladies and gentlemen, how Jesus is always found among sinners, and church folk are always trying to remove them, as if God does not know how to deal with people who keep on messing up. And the question becomes, who are we in this text? Are we like the sinners whose heart is far from God, struggling to believe Jesus, but shouting that he will still sit down with us? Or are we like Matthew, one who has already come to the master, who will open up our doors for our unsaved friends and say, come meet a man who's already changed my life? Or are we like the highfalutin judgmental Pharisees who are dissing people because we can't get over the problem of their past? Jesus said, the whole don't need a physician, only the sick. Now you go learn what that means. Maybe what it means is that some of us need to go back and learn some lessons we should have already learned. Lessons like forgiveness. Let the church shout forgiveness. That we are all human beings. We all make mistakes. We all fall short. We all sin. We all need forgiveness. And we all must be willing to forgive. We have to forgive while being forgiven at the same time. And somebody, you know, you came up in here today mad about what somebody said about you. When who cares? You've been talking about people too. You came up in here this morning mad and rolling your eyes over what somebody did to you. Who cares what they did to you? You've been doing stuff to people too. Some of y'all came in here talking about you ain't gonna never talk to them no more because they don't like you. Who cares? You got four or five people you don't like either. The truth of the matter is, if you expect to be forgiven, you've got to learn how to forgive. Life, ladies and gentlemen, is full of failure. One of the ways you know you're still alive is because you keep messing up. You say the wrong thing, do the wrong thing, think the wrong thing, go the wrong places, eat the wrong stuff, spend your money the wrong way, handle people the wrong way. You're just wrong. And here you are yelling at people for doing the same thing you do. You know I'm talking to you. You got road rage, talking about how bad people drive. Have you ever asked yourself how bad you drive? Hello, are you here? Now, if you can admit that about yourself, what makes you think God, if God ain't through with you, why do you think God is done with the person you sitting beside? All of us are works in progress. We need to throw this idea of perfectionism away. Maybe that's one of the handicaps and failures in the church. We've been telling folk a lie. If you join the church, you'll stop sinning. Some of us were born in church and we just as devilish as we were from the time we came out of our mother's womb. You got to understand that if we would learn to remember what God told Jeremiah, go down to the potter's house. Let me show you what I do to people who mess up. I don't throw them away. I keep remaking them and molding them and working on them to be who I want them to be. And I wish I had somebody in here who was grateful for God's makeover in your life. You are not what you want to be, but you thank God you are not what you used to be. Maybe, dear child of God, if we stop expecting people to be perfect and learn how to love them for who and what they are, maybe if we stop expecting to get us out of them and just appreciate them for who they are, maybe we could be happier people. Maybe the reason why you stay mad and discombobulated and frustrated is because you're trying to get you out of someone else. Newsflash, they ain't you. We need to be reminded all of us have sinned. All of us possess profound profanities in all of our lives. You may not do what they do, but you do something. And the church must deal with double standards and hypocrisies. That we don't have to keep tearing each other down just to make a point. Some of us need to stop telling that lie that we are not perfect. We are still profane. As a matter of fact, most of the people that God used in the Bible were profane people. So why the church trying to front like we perfect? If we told the truth, some of the people we like in the Bible, we wouldn't like them for real. We love singing about Jacob. As a matter of fact, we sing about him in church. We are climbing Jacob's ladder. Every round goes higher and higher. But the truth of the matter is none of us would like him for real. Why? He was a liar. He was a thief. He was a manipulator. But yet God used him. We like to talk about David. How David killed the giant Goliath. how David was a man after God's own heart, a true worshiper. We love the 23rd Psalm. We learned it coming through kindergarten. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. But the truth of the matter is, none of us would like David if we knew him for real. Why? He was an adulterer. He was a womanizer. David had so many women, good God Almighty, that when he was an old man and they were trying to figure out if the man was dead or not, one of his servants said, go get a girl. God help me. Go get a woman. Go find a woman and put her in the bed with him. If he get excited, he's still alive. But if he don't touch her, this man getting ready to die for real. We wouldn't like him. He was a murderer, and yet God used him. God rejected Saul and chose David. God uses dysfunction as an example of his love. Time and time again, humans mess up, but God uses that dysfunction to demonstrate that he can use ordinary people. Now, if God could use a hustler like Jacob and a whore like David, what makes you think he can't use that one you still talking junk about? Some of us need to go back and learn lessons on forgiveness. Some of us, ladies and gentlemen, been in church all our lives, and we still have missed the heart of God. We understand God in superficial ideas. We know what God can do, but we really don't know his heart. Why is he eating with sinners? One of the fascinating things about God is that God is omniscient. He knows everything. Has it ever occurred to you, ladies and gentlemen, that person that gets on your nerves the most was created in the image of God? You ever thought about the one that got you fired off your job? The one addicted to drugs? The one who tore up your house? The one who suffers from mental health disorders? That person is a child of God. It's easy, ladies and gentlemen, to judge and condemn folk when all we see is their behavior. We don't like their behavior, but we've never stopped to ask the question, why do they think the way they think? All we see is what they do, but we don't understand the reasons why. We judge what we see, but we don't even know what we're looking at. I don't like her because she drinks. Well, have you ever asked why she drinks? I don't like him because he's crazy. Have you ever asked yourself, why has he lost his mind? He doesn't trust anybody. Have you ever asked why she steals and she takes things that don't belong? You are talking about symptoms. What is the root cause? And the Pharisees were looking at symptoms. Why is he eating with sinners? And never got to the root cause. And can I tell you, there are some Pharisees in church. I might as well take my time. Looking and talking, but don't know what they looking and talking about. So stuck on stupid, they'd rather stay ignorant because they would hate to find out they were wrong. And the crazy part about it is, oftentimes people are looking for criticism in others to help themselves feel better about their own insecurities. Some people will take on the extra work to bring you down instead of making themselves better. But what they haven't figured out is that judging people is not a reflection of you, it's a reflection of them. And I rose to tell you, you've got to learn how to overcome the fear of being judged. They're going to judge you. You've got to learn how to get over that. Can I tell you how to do it? Number one, don't take it personal. If they were rude and messy and judgmental and argumentative before you met them, then that is proof whatever they tripping about now ain't got nothing to do with you, because they were that way before you stepped in their life. Preach, Keith. I'm doing it. Don't take it personal. But number two, never forget your own strength and your own limitations. Know what you're good at. Know your struggles without their critique. Don't ever let anybody strip you of your self-worth and your self-value. Don't let other people define you. Sure, they have a right to think what they want to think, but you also have a right to reject what they think when it comes to you. Some of us have not yet realized that judgmental dispositions are really defense mechanisms. God help me. Because we judge other people sometimes because whatever they are doing is messing with our own ego. So if we can't do better, or if we won't do better, we'll criticize them for doing better. Lord help me. Some people just need to learn how to practice seeing the basic good in other people. Here's what I want to tell you who are judgmental. Here's how you know if you're judgmental. People who act just like you get on your nerves the most. That's right. You are a judgmental person if you skip to the conclusion and you ain't even got all the facts. Struggle to see a person beyond their faults, but will bite somebody else's head off when you do the same thing. Isn't it amazing how somebody can do right 1,000 times, mess up 1 time, that's all you remember? Y'all don't want to talk to me. Isn't it something how a person can bend over backwards 1,000 times till you know 1 time, that's all you remember? Isn't it strange how we always look for the worst, but we rarely find the best? Some of us, even in church, can I tell you, there are some churches, no matter how you come, they ain't gonna like you. Some churches don't like you if you're rich. Some don't like you if you're poor. Some churches don't like you if you're white. Some churches don't like you if you're black. Some churches don't like you if you praise God. Some churches don't like you if you don't praise God. Some churches don't like you if you're gay. Some churches don't like you if you're divorced. Some churches don't like you if you wear a suit. Some churches don't like you if you wear a dress. Some folk don't like you if you're educated, if you got a GED. Some people just don't like you because they don't like you. Maybe the reason why we stay so divided because we have really forgotten that all of us are created in the image of God, and all of us have sinned, and all of us have come short of the glory of God. Jesus said the whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. Now you go and learn what that means. Jesus offended them because he sat down and ate with sinners. The problem with the text is that the Pharisees saw themselves as whole. Sinners already knew they were sick. Pharisees, here it is, never checked for Jesus because they concluded they didn't need him. And they didn't need him because they imagined themselves as already being whole when they were really sick. The sinners in the text had no false imagination of themselves. They knew they were messed up. They knew they needed a doctor. And for 20 of you listening to me in this room, you are not healthy because you said you're healthy. Truly healthy people are only healed sick people. But you will never get healed if you never acknowledge you're sick. I want to preach to somebody and tell you that person you ready to give up on is a child of God. That person who gets under your skin is a child of God. That we pick and choose who are God's children. We pick and choose who God has blessed. We pick and choose who has heard from God. We pick and choose who's right and wrong. We dominate, we argue, we exclude, we eradicate, we eliminate, we exterminate anything that doesn't fit our perception of who is a child of God. But I rose to preach the text, he still ate with them. Can I tell you why he ate with them and I'm out of here? He ate with them because nobody is beyond hope. Nobody is beyond the redeeming power of our God. And I wish I had some people who could tell the truth. You ain't always been half as holy as you are right now. We write people off because of their past. We write people off because of their problems. We write people off over what they said or what they did. But you ought to thank Jesus. God didn't write you off because you've been just as foul, just as nasty, just as wrong. The only difference is don't nobody know it. He ate with sinners because he loves sinners. I don't care what you did. God still loves you. I don't care how far you fail, God still loves you. I don't care how bad you messed up, God still loves you, and his love has a way of cleansing all of us. His love has a way of saving all of us. His love is an unbreakable kind of love. He ate with sinners because he loves sinners. He ate with them because he's merciful. I know you look good. I know you smell good. I know you're living good. I know you're driving good. But can you be honest? You still need mercy. I know you got your mask on and can't nobody see your lips moving, but somebody ought to shout out loud, I still need mercy. I got a decent house. I got a decent car. I got a decent job. Got a few pennies in the bank, but I ain't gonna fool myself. All of it can be gone in the morning. I need God on my side. I need God's mercy. I want to preach to somebody today who's not ashamed to call out on God. Not ashamed to tell God that you need him. You come to church today not to see who had on what. You came because you wanted to be in God's house, because you needed to feel his presence, because after all the hell you've been through, you want to know, is there any more mercy? I read my Bible not because I'm trying to win the Bible bee. I'm trying to find another chapter and verse that'll help me hold on to God's mercy. I serve God not to be seen. I serve God because I realize he saw me. And some folk don't know how sick they are. Don't know how wrong they are. Don't know how foolish they are. Oh, but I need thee every hour. I need thee. Bless me now. My Savior, I come to thee. Sin has wore us out. Mistakes made us look stupid. But Jesus, I wish I had some help in here. I wish I had some people in here who understood that you fell, but you got back up. Made mistakes, you lived and you learned. You've been hurt, but you healed from your hurt. You did wrong, but God gave you another chance. You're not perfect. You're a human being, and you've learned how to count your blessings. Do I have any company in this building who knows the reason why you praise God is because he never gave up on you? Keep your mask on. Don't touch nobody. Just look at him and say, I shout because he never gave up on me. If you only knew how many people gave up on me, if you only knew how many people walked out the door on me, if you only knew how many people thought it was over, but God reached way down and he picked me back up. Thank you for your mercy. He ate with them because he loved them. He ate with him because he understood that nobody is beyond redemption. He ate with them because he knew they needed a Savior. He ate with them because he loved them. And I want you to know, somebody in this room, somebody on the other side of that camera, you messed up. You've been listening to the devil all week. But I came to remind you that God still loves you. No matter how wrong you went, God still loves you. You understand that a title didn't make you money, didn't make you a position, didn't make you what they gave you, didn't make you. God made you, and God made you. He redeemed you and saved you and gave you grace and mercy. And there are people who tried to judge you when they didn't even know your story. People were looking at you today, and they had no clue of what yesterday looked like for you. You came to church, shouted, ran around the sanctuary, and they looked and pointed and laughed, and they had no idea. This time last year, you were almost dead, but God made a way. I'm done. I'm finished. But all I want you to understand is that the very one you were criticizing, could it be that your finger is in their face so hard because you just like them? Could it be that they aggravate you so much because you see yourself in them and it's easier to judge them, Lord have mercy, than to do the hard work of fixing yourself? Could it be, ladies and gentlemen,
that your self-righteousness is exactly what disqualified you from getting the blessing God wanted you to have. But if you lowered your head and beat your chest and say, God, it's me standing in the need of prayer. He make a way for you. Somebody, I need you to give God glory, because he didn't throw you away when he should have. He didn't walk away from you when he should have. He didn't let you go when he should have. Some of us don't know how to praise God because we don't know how down we were, how messed up we were, how broke we were. We were steady pointing the finger at everybody else, but God did it for me, and he did it for you. He ate with sinners because he loved them. Maybe the church would be a better church after quarantine, after pandemic, if we completely threw the whole idea of perfection away. I ain't trying to be perfect. I'm just trying to get close to God. And the closer I get to God, God will work out the kinks in my life and make me who he wants me to be. Stop trying to live up to somebody else's expectation of you. And learn who and how to be who God wants you to be. If you can celebrate where you are in life right now, can you give God the best praise you have? May not be perfect, but you're better than what you used to be. Can you give God glory that you've come a mighty long way? When you look back over your life and think things over, God has been good to you. We thank God for his grace, for his mercy. There are things people are upset with you about that you didn't even ask for. Some blessings you have, you didn't ask for those blessings. God gave them to you. And some people mad at you over what God wanted you to have. And instead of them looking to God for their own blessing, criticizing you over yours. But don't miss your next miracle worried about people who judge you. They're going to do that anyway. Just keep being great, even if you got to do it with you and God. Notice, it's the church folk that have the problem with Jesus. It's not the sinner. And could it be during this season of quarantine? Well, we've been out of church for almost a year. Maybe God is hitting the reset button on the church. Because we've been so caught up in traditions and customs, we forgot how to throw up our hands and worship God. It ain't about your suit. It ain't about your title. It ain't about where you sit. It's about, do you know God? And have you come to Jesus for yourself? Matthew had a dinner. Invited all his friends, all kind of different people. And Jesus sat with them and ate with them. There's some moments in all of our lives where we thank God that even though we were not there yet, he sat down and ate with us. And in the breaking of bread, instead of him judging and throwing us away, he healed us. Anybody ever felt God heal you? No, I'm serious. Have you ever felt God heal you? I'm talking about where you hurt the most. You ever felt that kind of relief? That weight coming off your spirit? you weren't quite there yet. Still had a long way to go. So-called Christians pointed their finger, talked about you, and you almost believed it. You almost gave up on yourself. But God sat down with you, shared a meal with you, and somewhere in that breaking of bread, you saw yourself getting better. You saw yourself doing better. Saw yourself becoming more than you ever would have imagined or dreamed. God says to somebody in this room today, I am making you over in front of them. That the very one who said you wouldn't make it, I will keep their eyes open long enough so that they will watch me do in your life what they said could never be done. Why? Because he's going to eat with you. He'll walk with you. Closer than a brother. He's God, our Savior. If you love the Lord today, come on, give God hand praise. Father, we thank you. We love you. We adore you. We thank you, God, for sticking with us. We thank you, God, that we did not believe the opinions of others, but we fixed our eye on what you were doing in our life. And help us, oh God, because sometimes it's not the others, sometimes it's us. We've judged people. We've come to conclusions that were so far away from the pronouncement you had on their life. Regardless of what we think, see, or say, they are your child. And you're doing something special in their lives. Even if we can't see it. Even if we can't believe it. Because we too can testify, you did some things with us nobody would have ever thought possible. And so God, if you're still working on us, give us more grace. Give us more mercy. Give us more love to give to the one we're so ready to give up on. We give your name thanks, praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name we do pray. Come on, clap your hands and say amen. Some information is on your screen now. We ask that you call that number if you don't have a church home. If you send us an email, if you do not have a pastor, I'd love to be your pastor. We'd love to be a place where you can learn and grow and participate and become all that God has called you to be. We love you out there. Stay safe, stay sane, stay satisfied. Lord, take this word, bury it deep in our heart, that'll bring forth fruit in due season. We shall forever give your name the praise, the honor, and the glory. And now unto him that is able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. Now unto him, the only wise God, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both henceforth, now, and forevermore. Let us all say amen. We'll see you next Sunday.